Jesus traveled to Jerusalem for a yearly festival called the Passover. There, he ate a special meal with his disciples. At the table, Jesus took a piece of bread and a cup of wine that symbolized the flesh and blood of sacrificed animals. God had given the Israelites animal sacrifices, a way for their sins to be forgiven. When Jesus took the bread and wine, he said, "This is my body. This is my blood, poured out for the forgiveness of sins." Later that night, Jewish religious leaders arrested Jesus and handed him over to the Roman government, where a group of soldiers stripped him, put a scarlet robe on him, and placed a crown of sharp, twisted thorns on his head. They put a staff in his right hand, knelt down, and began to mock him. "Hail, King of the Jews!" they yelled. Throughout that night, the soldiers mocked and beat Jesus. Then he was sentenced by the government to death by crucifixion, a horrible, violent form of execution. The soldiers forced Jesus to carry a heavy wooden beam through the streets and up onto a hillside. They nailed long spikes through Jesus' wrists, attaching them to the beam. Then they took another beam and formed a cross with it, nailing Jesus' feet to the bottom. They lifted the cross up and left Jesus to hang there. In the middle of the day, it became dark like it was night. This lasted for 3 hours. In the dark, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Then Jesus said, "It is finished," and died. At that exact moment, an earthquake shook the city, and the large curtain in the Jewish temple was torn in two. When the guards who were standing near the cross saw what happened, they yelled out, "Surely he was the Son of God." Some of Jesus' followers took his body down off the cross, wrapped it in clean linens, and placed it in a nearby tomb cut out of a hillside. They rolled a large stone in front of the entrance and left. Roman soldiers guarded the tomb so that no one would steal the body. Then, just 3 days later, Jesus' mother Mary and another follower of Jesus named Mary went to the tomb, hoping to place spices inside the tomb. But when they arrived, another earthquake shook the ground, and an angel of God came down from heaven, rolled back the stone, and sat on it. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know you are looking for Jesus. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. Go, tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead." And as they were running, Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. The women came to him, clasping his feet and worshiping him. Jesus was alive.
The invitation that Milo just extended to you with the words of that song duplicate an invitation that you will be asked to consider at the very end of this service. Because you, Jesus Christ, gave your life for me, I will give my life to you. It's the reason for this service today. So I ask you from beginning to end, in the midst of maybe occasional bit of frivolity, that you will keep that in mind. I'm trusting most of you received the midweek reminder about being here today. If you didn't get it in an email, that means we don't have your email. So take a card, put your name and your email address on it. We'll see that you get it. But as you'll recall, I challenged you this week in that email that just because this third key truth that we're looking at today is salvation, and some of you say, "I'm already saved. I don't need to worry about going. I can stay home and watch the Raiders." I know that what you really mean by that is you're going to watch Derek Carr, okay? I really understand that's what you mean. Okay, I'll give occasional updates throughout the sermon. We had the largest 9 o'clock crowd we've ever had in the history of New Hope today. I mean, 8 o'clock, yeah, 8 o'clock service, all because people want to get home for the lineup that's there today. Thank you for being here, but I'm asking you. You see, the Bible tells us that Jesus said, not me, Jesus, he said, not everybody who calls me Lord has entered into my kingdom. Jesus was saying, you can be very active in your religion, but you may have no relationship with me. If you're new to New Hope, we're in the midst of a series. We're 1/10 of the way through. We're in a 30-week series called Believe. We're looking at 10 key truths out of the Bible, 10 key practices, and 10 key virtues. This is the foundation of what it means to be a Christian. And of course, you can't have virtues and practices unless you're building those on a solid foundation of truth. There are far more truths than 10 in the Bible, but these 10 that we are looking at are absolutely foundational, and they are in pretty significant order of priority. We looked first week at God. He is. Last week, we looked at this God who is, wants to be personal with you, though He is transcendent, and though He is providential, and though He is immanent, He wants to be engaged personally with each and every one of us. So today we're going to look at how this God who is and this God who wants to be personal, how do we have a relationship with this transcendent God on a personal level? And that's what today is all about. The music and the prayers and the message, all to draw us in. Do I have the kind of personal relationship with God that He wants to have with me? So thank you, Milo. Sung beautifully today. Thank you. Welcome to New Hope. Great to have you here. If you are visiting with us for the very first time, welcome. There's a visitor card in the pew in front of you. I hope you'll pull it out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag when it comes by, and next week through the mail, we'll send you information of what's going on around New Hope Church. We always promise we will not beat on your door or bother you on the phone, but through the mail, send you information we hope will be very, very helpful to you. Let me highlight very quickly a few announcements and then a couple of prayer requests, and we will get engaged into our service this morning. 8 o'clock service told me the preacher was just a little bit long. Homeless outreach today, all right, right after the third service, right over in the Murbach building. All right, folks are going to be preparing sandwiches and food and other necessary items to take out to the west side of Fresno and to greet and share and minister to the homeless. Senior luncheon this Tuesday. If you are 55 or older, you are an invited guest. If you've been before, you know the routine. If you've never been, just show up, all right? Grief Share starts this Wednesday night at 6:45. If you would like to be part of Grief Share, it's a small group Bible study. If you've experienced death and loss in your life and would like to be with a group of others who might be able to help you with that, please sign up so they have enough material. The second sheet is for Tuesday night women's Bible study. They start this coming Tuesday night, also here at the church, and so please sign up so they have enough materials available. Save the date, all right? The first ever Hope Fest in the New Hope parking lot, October the 24th. That is a Friday night. We will be sharing with three other churches in the area, New Covenant down the street in Fresno, Mountain View on the south side of Clovis, and then North Park on the north side of Fresno and Clovis. We will be sharing together an evening of our worship bands, all right? We could say it's the worship band competition, except we're not competing. We are all sharing together in the worship of the Lord together. So it's kind of our version of Woodstock, all right? Except there won't be any pot, all right? Except for the portable potties, all right, that will be out there. But anyway, so come up and join us that evening. It should be a lot of fun. More to come. Children's drama rehearsal, it's in your bulletin. It's posted all around the church. That starts next Sunday afternoon, elementary age kids in a musical drama presentation. The church golf tournament, there's an insert in your bulletin regarding that coming up in October. Please come register. It's for men and women, young and old, whether you're very good or not, all right? And it all goes to help celebrate recovery, all right? So that's in October. Then the Hubbard Barrow tournament is in November. It's always on Veterans Day, so 11-11. This will be the 10th annual Hubbard Barrow golf tournament. We have the fountain right out here that was built in tribute to the first two young men from Buchanan High School that were killed at the same time in Iraq. There's been a golf tournament the following year that has been started. It's been 10 years since the very first one. And so this will be a very special one. Go online to Hubbard Barrow and you'll find it and get yourself registered. They sell out early. Next Sunday, Mike Cousineau will be with us in our three morning worship services, but only taking about 5 minutes. We will have a Sunday evening service next Sunday night at 6 o'clock. Hope you'll come and join us. Mike Cousineau will be sharing, and Tim Kepler will be doing some music for us that night. Tim will be with us Sunday morning, Sunday evening. And I want you to come back on Sunday night because I'm going to be asking you to consider adopting a village in the Ivory Coast of Africa. And I want you to hear the information about what God is doing in that village and how we here in California could make a difference for the next 5 years in that community. So that will be next Sunday evening. On September the 19th, there's also an insert in your bulletin. Show Hope is being done over at Clovis Hills, all right? And so I think if they are going to show hope, New Hope ought to be there, all right? And Stevens Curtis Chapman is going to be leading that, going to be leading in worship. And what this is for is to expose the communities of Fresno and Clovis how we can show hope to those who are orphans and a ministry that's out there that we can connect to. So that's on September the 19th. A couple of prayer requests. Vita Bond from our 8 o'clock service having all kinds of health challenges. Please remember her. Diane Fletcher and her two uncles, all of them are having physical challenges right now. And Kevin and Kim Clay, and they're sitting right back over there. Nick, their son, he's leaving for Marine boot camp next Sunday. So please, please be praying for Nick. All right, somebody remembers how to do that. All right, good job, guys. I'm going to ask our ushers, if they would, to come forward at this time and wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offerings. Would you please join with us as we pray? Ladies and gentlemen, all right, let's pray. Father, I love you. Thank you so very, very much for the expression of your love for us. Father, in light of today's music and message, the scripture, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. That is the greatest expression of love that's ever been known in the history of the world. What a shame for any of us to let that extravagant love go to waste in our own life. I pray, Father, that as we sing and pray and study your word, that we will be reminded of your great love and your great sacrifice. I trust you with the needs that we've expressed today, and I also trust you with the needs that are personal and private within our hearts. You are a God who can listen to all of us at one time and not get one bit confused. You never forget. So thank you, Father. Father, I pray that there will be an outpouring of your activity within our midst today. And I trust if there are some who have grappled for a while with making a choice about having a relationship with you, that that wrestling match will end today. Father, if there are others who have thought they were saved, but Father, it was just a mirage. It was just a veneer. I pray that will be shattered today and reality will set in and new life will be discovered. And Father, for those of us who've walked with you for a long time, if we've become a bit stale, or maybe, Father, we've become a bit indifferent, Father, may the work of your Spirit in our midst today revive us and refresh us and renew us for the adventure that you have in store for us. For the privilege of giving and sharing to you today, we say thank you. In the awesome, incredible, marvelous name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. You just had the old and the new as we sang In the Garden. It's about as old as it gets in the church, all right, around here. And then you had the brand new written this past week by Milo. So thank you very, very much, guys. I'm going to ask you to extend grace to your pastor today. These first 7-8 minutes of the message, I want you to be patient. It's going to be a rather strong challenge. I don't want you to think I'm saying something that I don't intend or I don't mean. So don't shut me off, all right, if I step on your toes a bit. If I hit your last nerve, just please be patient with me for a few minutes. I told you at the first sermon of the series that the subject of God, the truth about God, is absolutely the most important, and it is. For it is out of our belief in that truth and in Him
that everything else we talk about the next 29 weeks has its foundation. But with that as the foundation for us personally, for the difference that a truth can make in our life, there is not a sermon more important. There's not a subject more significant out of these 30 than this one today. This is the one that brings the reality of God and who He is, and an understanding of us and where we are, and it brings those two together. It is the hinge between God and us that makes Him personal. So it's that important. I want to play a little Bible trivia game at the outset. Here is the question. Let me give you the question so as I go through a litany of people out of the Bible, you'll know kind of how to be thinking and how you might answer this question. I will tell you that the 8 o'clock service got it the very first time. Pressure's on. What do they all have in common? That's the question. What do they all have in common? Now let me tell you the they. Nicodemus, who was a Pharisee. A guy I don't know the name of, but if you've ever read the Bible much at all, you'll recognize this guy right away. He's known as the rich young ruler, all right? Tall, dark, and handsome, and wealthy, all rolled into one package. There's a woman. I don't know her name either. She's just a brief appearance, but yet, as soon as I give you a little bit about her, you're all going to know who I'm talking about. The woman caught in adultery, in the very act of adultery, all right? And what I always find fascinating about her is, where's the man caught in the very act of adultery? I mean, if she was caught in the act, there had to be a man there, right? All right, where was he? Well, they didn't bring him. Next, a little short guy. Yeah, Zacchaeus, a tax collector, IRS agent. Then another guy, I don't know his name, but he was known as the Ethiopian eunuch. All right, in the book of Acts. He was the CPA for his government. Then there's another guy, I don't know his name, but the prodigal son. The baby boy of a wealthy Jewish farmer. Then there was a politician and his wife, Governor Felix and his wife Drusilla. And you thought Drusilla was only in 101 Dalmatians. Not true. She originated in the Bible. There's another woman, I don't know her name because it's not given to us, but we know her well. She was the woman at the well, yeah. And then there's a guy called Saul of Tarsus, later became known as Paul the Apostle. He was a well-educated religious official intent on stamping out faith in Jesus Christ. Then there was a centurion by the name of Cornelius. There's another political guy, Governor Festus, and his buddy, King Agrippa. There's a lady talked about in the book of Acts. Her name was Lydia. She was the first woman liber, I think. She was a businesswoman, very successful businesswoman from Thyatira. And then the jailer in Philippi, who was about to commit suicide because the doors of the jail flung open and he thought all of his prisoners had escaped and he would be executed. What do all of these people, men and women, have in common? Sinners? Well, that's true. That's not the answer I'm looking for, though. Seekers? Yeah, well, yeah, they should have been, but maybe not. Well, not all of them were saved, but you were, you're getting warm. Well, all of them had the opportunity to be saved. All of them had been extended an opportunity to become the recipient of salvation, but not all of them were born again. Keep that in mind as we head on. If you were to Google the Barna Group online, you would find this is an organization that specializes in religious research and statistics. If you went there, you would look at the titles of some of the research they have done. And one of those titles is Born Again Christians, Just as Likely to Divorce as Non-Christians. And if you're starting to get a little nervous, remember, I've been there. I'm not picking on anybody. It's just there doesn't seem to be any difference, according to this statistic of how the world behaves and in this arena how the church may function. The same kind of statistics are given in a book written by Ron Sider, in a book called The Scandal of the Evangelical Conscience. Why are Christians living just like the rest of the world? There's another book called by Mark Regenerous called Forbidden Fruit, Sex and Religion in the Lives of American Teenagers. You see, there's an indication that the church in America, I'm not talking about the rest of the world, but the church in America are not unlike those who are not believers. What I'm picking up as I investigate and read in all three of these areas is the term born again is being used. The Barna Group in particular uses it to report their research. So that report is titled, Born Again Christians Just as Likely to Divorce as Non-Christians. Sider uses the word evangelicals in his book, but he points out similar kinds of things, like only 9% of evangelicals tithe. I find that interesting. Only 9% give 10%. Thank you. Four of you thought that was humorous. I did. I thought it was rather funny. Of 12,000 teenagers, this next thing I don't find funny. Of 12,000 teenagers who took the pledge to wait for marriage, 80% had sex outside of marriage in the next 7 years. 26% of traditional evangelicals do not think premarital sex is wrong. White evangelicals are more likely than Catholics and mainline Protestants to object to having black neighbors. I find that disgusting. In other words, the evangelical church as a whole in this country is apparently not unlike the rest of the world. We go to church on Sunday, we have this veneer of religion, but its religion is basically an add-on to the same way of life the way the rest of the world lives, not a radically transforming power. Reminds me of something I remember Major Thomas saying again and again, when he said there are few things quite so boring as being religious. But there is nothing quite so exciting as being a Christian. Most folks have never discovered the difference between one and the other. So that there are those who sincerely try to live a life they do not have, religion, substituting religion for God, Christianity for Christ, and their own noble endeavors for the energy, joy, and power of the Holy Spirit who could live within them. In the absence of reality, they only grasp at ritual, stubbornly defending the latter in the absence of the former, lest they be found with neither. What a profound mistake. I want to say loud and clear that when the Barna Group uses the term born again to describe American churchgoers whose lives are indistinguishable from the world and who sin as much as the world and who sacrifice for others as little as the world and who embrace injustice as readily as the world and covet things as greedily as the world and enjoy God-ignoring entertainment enthusiastically as the world, when the term born again is used to describe these professing Christians, the Barna Group is making a profound mistake. It is using the term born again in a way that would be unrecognizable by Jesus and by the biblical authors. Here is the way these researchers define born again. Born again Christians were defined in these surveys as people who said they have a personal commitment to Christ and it's important in their daily life. Who also indicated they believe that when they die they will go to heaven because they confessed their sins and accepted Christ as Savior. Respondents were not asked to describe themselves as born again. They were classified as being born again. In other words, the research, and use the term, it refers to people who say things. They say I have a personal commitment. They say I believe I will go to heaven. They say I have confessed sins and accept Christ as Savior. Then the Barna Group takes them at their word and ascribes to them the infinitely important reality of a new birth and then blasphemes that precious biblical reality by saying regenerate hearts have no more victory over sin than unregenerate hearts. Oh me. The New Testament would not align itself with the methodology of Barna's research. I'm not saying that Barna's research is wrong. Sadly, I believe it is appallingly right. I'm not saying that the church is not as worldly as they say it is. I'm saying that the writers of the New Testament think exactly in the opposite direction of what it means to be born again. Instead of moving from a profession of faith to the label born again, to the worldliness of these so-called born again people, to the conclusion that new birth does not radically change people, the New Testament moves in the opposite direction. It moves from absolute certainty that new birth radically changes who we are and what our life will be like, to the observation that many professing Christians are indeed, as the Barna Group says, not radically changed, to a possible conclusion from the New Testament that they may not really be saved. The New Testament, unlike the Barna Group, does not defile the new birth with the worldliness of unregenerate professing American Christians. And that is the reason Jesus said, not everybody who says, Lord, Lord, has entered my kingdom. It's not just a 21st century problem, folks. That problem existed in the first century church. It is the reason I believe that the beloved disciple John wrote 1 John. 1 John, don't try to turn to it here, okay? 1 John 2:29. Let me just take you through five verses in 1 John. If you know that he is righteous, you may be sure that everyone who practices righteousness has been born of him. Number two, 1 John 3:9. No one born of God makes a practice of sinning, for God's seed abides in him, and he cannot keep on sinning because he has been born of God. Do not misunderstand that verse. It doesn't say that if you become a Christian, you will never sin again. But what it does say is if you have been born again, there is no way you can continue to practice sinning. Because when you sin, God will bring conviction and discipline in your life, and you'll say, oh yeah, God, I messed up, and you'll get back on track. But you won't continue a lifestyle of sin. 1 John 4:7, beloved, let us love one another, for love is from God, and whoever loves has been born of God and knows him. 1 John 5:4, everyone who has been born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that has overcome the world, our faith. Instead of the world overcoming us, we should be overcoming the world. 1 John 5:18, we know that everyone who has been born of God does not keep on sinning. Is it not true that these statements appear to be written with the very claims of the Barna Group in mind? Namely, that born-again people are morally indistinguishable from the world? The Bible is profoundly aware of such people in the church, and that is one reason 1 John was written. But instead of following the Barna Group, the Bible says that the research is not finding that born-again people are permeated with worldliness. The research is finding that the church is permeated by people who were not born again. And that distressed me this week. What if at New Hope Church, because we have not done our job in preaching God's truth in its fullness, that we have folks who come week after week after week who say, Lord, Lord, but do not have the Lord in them. As a shepherd, I would have failed miserably in the responsibilities God has entrusted. And so today, this is not a message of condemnation. If anything, I trust this will become a message of liberation for all of us. But I am asking you to seriously give thought as we go through the rest of this sermon. Am I a genuine believer in Jesus Christ? Do I have a relationship with Him? Not because I came to church three Sundays in a row, not because my parents were Christians, not because I even joined New Hope Church, but am I a Christian on the basis of what the Bible says are the steps to being a believer with Jesus Christ? Now, with that dark backdrop, let's watch a video and show you what God offers to us, whoever or wherever we may be, as a sinner in need of a Savior. Let's watch. Thank you.
It has listed for us there Ephesians 2, 8 and 9. For it is by grace we have been saved through faith. This is not something we've done out of our own abilities or ingenuity, but this is a gift of God. It is not by works and human effort, so nobody can brag or boast about how they've gotten what God has given. I love that video. When I saw it earlier this week, I said, oh, I just wanted to go out and jump in the mud. Because that's so much fun. All right? It's so much fun. It's exactly what the Bible says about sin. Sin is so much fun. Until you have to go home and crawl in bed all muddy. Until how you wake up the next morning and put on clean clothes over a muddy body. Until you have to go to work with all the mud. Until you have to go have dinner with all the mud. Until you have to go have, hang out at your friend's house with all the mud. See, the Bible says that there's joy, there's pleasure, there's fun in sin for a season. But when that season comes to an end, it's destructive and devastating. God does not come with a big mallet to smash us in the mud. Jesus comes to the barn with a water hose. And he said, if you'll submit to me, you have nothing to fear, for I'll clean you up on the inside and out. You see, if I believe there is a God, the one true and living God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and that He is a God who is personal, and that this great transcendent God cares about me and the daily adventure that I call life, that leads me to a most significant question. How do I, in the midst of the mudsty that I'm in, how do I have a personal relationship with this transcendent God? My focus for the next few minutes is going to be looking at five different passages of Scripture, each one addressing this question explicitly. Passage number one, you will not find it in your Believe, all right? It's found in Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 22. Mark writes in his gospel where Jesus had an encounter with that rich guy I was telling you about a few minutes ago. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees. And before him, he said, good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life? That is every preacher's dream. He said, well, he's walking down the road. Some guy just run up to him and say, pastor, what do I have to do to get saved? It's never happened to me. It has never happened. Closest I've come is a junior high teacher walked into the bookstore I was working at when I worked for Fresno Bible House, and this Marine who, as my teacher, was always neat and clean and sharp and right on the money, and he came in on a Saturday morning disheveled and unkempt. He didn't know I was working there, but when he saw me, he walked back to the Bible counter and he said, my life's a mess. I remember you talking about Jesus in my class. 3 days later, I had the privilege of leading him to the Lord in his office. Once in 60 years, something like that has happened. What did Jesus say? Jesus said, why do you call me good? No one is good except for God alone. You know the commandments, young man. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony or defraud others. Honor your mama and your papa. Teacher, he declared, all these I have kept since I was a boy. Jesus looked at him and said, one thing you lack. Go sell everything that you have and give it to the poor. And you will have treasures in heaven. Then come and follow me. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Here we find a key question. The man himself asked it, what must I do to inherit eternal life? We see that the Scripture says Jesus looked at him, and notice this. This tells us how personal God wants to be with us. Jesus looked at him, and he loved him. He looked in the eyes of this hungry young man, and love filled his heart. Jesus wasn't trying to trick or belittle the young ruler, but rather Jesus was attempting to lead him to a truth about himself. While the focus is often placed on the rich man walking away sad, don't miss the fact that Jesus invited this guy to come with him. Take this passage at face value.
here's what we would conclude. From this passage, we would say, if you want a relationship with God and you want eternal life, then we need to do good works. Just hang with me. We're going to loop back to this statement in a minute. Don't be concerned that I'm emphasizing salvation by works. We're building a spiritual progression of thought throughout the Scripture, so hold on. Passage number 2 is found on page 55 and 56 in Believe. In your regular Bibles, it's John chapter 3, verses 1 through 7 and verse 16. John in his Gospel tells the encounter of Jesus with Nicodemus. Here's how it reads. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, and he came to Jesus at night. If you've been here very long, you've heard me refer to this moment as the very first episode of Nick at Night. Okay? And he said, Rabbi, we know that you were a teacher and you have come from God. Jesus replied, very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. How can someone be born when they're old? Nicodemus asked. Surely you cannot enter a second time into your mother's womb to be born. Jesus answered, very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water. What breaks before you have a human birth? Water. So until you have had physical birth, you cannot be born of the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit to the Spirit. You should not be surprised, Nick, at my saying, you must be born again. How can this be? Nicodemus asked. For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever does what? Believes in Him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus was describing the spiritual rebirth that God requires and Jesus came to offer, along with God's motivation for sending His Son into the world, and that was the incredible love of a transcendent God for all of His creation. Therefore, if you and I want a relationship with God and eternal life, then Jesus says we must believe in Him. Third passage, found on page 37 and 38. Okay? 57 and 58. I think I wrote 57 and 58, I believe. Did I mess up on that? Yeah, 50. No. Oh, no, it's not in there. That's verse 37 and 38. Acts chapter 2, verses 14, 21, 37, and 38. Sorry, this one's not in Believe. But it's in the Bible, so you can believe it. The day of Pentecost had come. 120 disciples were huddled together in an upper room. They were a little confused after Jesus had ascended into heaven. As Jesus had promised, the Holy Spirit had come and filled their lives. The church had been birthed in that upper room that day. And here's what the Scripture says, beginning at verse 14 in Acts 2. Peter stood up with the 11. He raised his voice and addressed the crowd. That's why preachers are loud. Peter was, all right? Fellow Jews and the rest of y'all that live in Jerusalem. Peter was a little bit country. Let me explain this to you. Listen carefully to what I say. And everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and they said to Peter and the other apostles, brothers, what shall we do? You see a little pattern going here? Rich young ruler comes to Jesus. What must I do? Nicodemus comes to Jesus. What must I do? These guys on the day of Pentecost, what must we do? Peter replied, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sin, and you will receive the life of God and the person of the Holy Spirit within your human spirit. The people heard this amazing message, and Peter delivered it. And much like the rich man Jesus encountered, they asked, what should we do? On this day, they did not walk away sad. 3,000 plus understood and accepted the life of Jesus Christ. They turned around from walking away from God, and they turned to walk with Him. This is what it means to repent. It's a 180-degree turn of our mind and our heart, which begins the process of transformation and sanctification. I met a new friend this week. I wish I could tell you his name, but it was so hard to pronounce and so long, I just called him Q. Okay? He's 38 years old. He lives in Kansas City now. He was originally out of Iowa. Q's about this tall. Broad shoulders, okay? Black. Spent 7 years in prison. He's now a leader of in prison fellowship nationwide, in churches that are interested in transforming and being available to inmates. And so we had a long conversation. And I love this guy. Don't tell Joe, but I told him if he was ever wanted to get back into local church ministry, New Hope just might have a place for him. I sat and listened to his story. At 14 years of age, he told a young lady who was 19 that he was 17. And he fathered a child with her. He was part of a gang, stealing, robbing, graffiti, beating up people. Eventually was incarcerated and spent 7 years. When he got out, his child was 3 years old, I believe. He laid in bed one night and he said, God, I'm going to be dead in 6 months if there's not a change in my life. He said, I don't know if you exist, but if you do, tomorrow you need to reveal yourself to me. He didn't know any better. Next morning, not long after he wakes up, there's a knock at his door. He goes and opens the door. There's a preacher standing at his door he's never met. Preacher said, I have a Bible for you. I want you to start reading at Matthew. Don't read the Old Testament. It'll just confuse you. But just start at Matthew and read. He handed me the Bible and he left. I never laid eyes on that preacher ever again. Have no idea who he is or where he came from. But God answered my cry. He said, I started reading in Matthew. He said, it didn't take me very long to read. It tells me I shouldn't commit adultery or fornication. So he said, I told my girlfriend who I was living with, we can't do this anymore. She said, why? He said, because I don't know about the Old Testament, but the New Testament says, I can't do this. I also can't marry you because it says we cannot be unequally yoked together. Brand new Christian. Brand new believer. Putting into practice what he's already learning. Long story short, because it's a great story. Long story short, after about 2 years, she becomes a Christian. They're now married. I believe they have 3 children and God's using them in a very powerful way. Wonderful, wonderful guy. You see, Q, 180-degree turn. I believe that's what the rich young ruler wasn't willing to do. It wasn't the selling of his riches. It was the about face. Passage 4, believe and profess. This is found on page 57 of Believe, Romans chapter 10, verses 1 through 4. Paul writes this, brothers and sisters, my heart's desire and my prayer to God for the Israelites is that they may be saved. For I can testify about them that they are zealous for God. These folks were religious, but their zeal is not based on knowledge. Since they did not know the righteousness of God and they tried to establish their own, they did not submit to God's righteousness. Christ is the culmination of the law so that there may be righteousness for everyone who is willing to believe. The Israelites were very religious, but they had the wrong strategy. They were trying to develop a righteousness of their own. They were trying to be good enough to work it out on their own so that they could deserve a relationship with God. In essence, Paul said, works don't work. Works don't work. They're only good enough. The only one good enough for God was Jesus. Jesus fulfilled all the requirements of the law when we trust in Him. His righteousness is transferred to our account. This is the only solution. So how do we pull off this transaction? Well, Paul tells us on page 57, Romans 10, 9 and 10, if we declare with our mouth that Jesus is Lord and we believe in our heart that God raised Him from the dead, we will be saved. For it is with our heart that you believe and are justified. It is with your mouth you profess your faith and you are saved. Believe with your heart, profess with your mouth. This brand of confession must originate in the heart. An internal decision that brings an outward demonstration of confession. A very similar concept to a previous passage. Repent and be baptized. Therefore, if we want to have a relationship with God and have eternal life, Paul says, we must believe and profess. Salvation is personal, but it is not private. I want to say that one again. Salvation is personal, but it is not private. I have heard people over the years say the same thing about a relationship with God that they do politics. You ought to keep it to yourself. Wrong. The Bible says the world will know we are Christians by our love. They're going to what? No. That means it can't be private. It's got to be public. There has to be this expression of who Christ is in our lives. That expression doesn't mean every time you walk up to somebody, you say, hey, God loves you. May I pray with you? Nothing wrong with that. Had a guy do that to me at the gas station yesterday. Pulled up a guy I met somewhere. I really don't remember him. I say that not negatively towards him. I say that just because I don't remember. And he waved at me and said, hey, man, it's good to see you again. He said, how's life? And I said, man, it's good, better than it ought to be. And he said, oh, isn't that true? Can I pray for you? And we stood right there in the middle of gas pumps, and he prayed for me. It was awesome. It was cool, all right? That's not my style. And that may not be yours. But, man, does anybody know? We shouldn't be secret believers in Jesus Christ. This is great stuff that happened to us. We ought to want to share it with others. Passage 5. I went off on a little tangent there. I'm sorry. Ephesians 2, 8, 9, page 42, all right, page 42. Come to faith by grace. It is by grace we've been saved through faith. It's not of ourselves. It is a gift of God, not by works, so no one can brag or boast. In reality, faith is not a separate category from believe. They come from the same root word in the New Testament. And Paul clearly adds fresh insights to this salvation transaction. The word grace means we do not deserve it. We are not entitled to it. God is not obligated to offer it to us. Yet He makes this offer of His righteousness that we cannot achieve on our own. To respond, we must express faith in who Jesus is and receive what He has done for us. Notice the phrase, not by works. This is not different from where we began with the words of Jesus to the rich man to do good works. At first, this might seem to be a conflict between Paul and Jesus. But actually, Jesus knew the young man had never and could never keep the law perfect. Remember, Jesus gave him 4 or 5 of the laws? And he said, hey, I've done that. Jesus said, okay, let me give you one and see if you can do this one. What Jesus wanted to hear from the rich young ruler was the rich young ruler to say, Jesus, I can't do it. And Jesus would say, I know you can't. That's what I've come to do for you. But rather, the rich young ruler confessing his inability, he went off independently on his own. See, God never said we could do what was necessary to become a Christian. It is why He sent His Son, and it is why we must confess, believe, repent, and turn, so that it's all about Him. Salvation is from Christ alone, and our acceptance of His gift must genuinely come from the expression of faith within our hearts. All of these verses together form the central truth, the key idea to go along with the key truth today. The key idea is I believe I come into a right relationship with God by God's grace through faith in Jesus Christ. How do we do this? George Swanson thought he had a plan to get to heaven. He was going to be buried in his white Corvette. He planned to drive his vet down the highway to heaven and arrive at the pearly gates in style. That's what his local newspaper said. That was George Swanson's plan. Unfortunately for him, that is not God's plan. God's plan is found in the book of Romans in our Bible. It's called the Roman Road to Salvation. To get to heaven, we must get there by the way of God's truth. God's plan is to give His priceless salvation as a free gift to any and all who will trust Him and demonstrate their faith publicly by confessing Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord. God's plan for salvation is applicable to all people. It's available to from the irreligious to the religious, from the bad like Hugh was to the good, from the illiterate to the educated, the young to the old, the poor to the wealthy, the sick to the healthy, the feeble to the strong, from the nutty to the wise. It is an all-encompassing plan. God has opened the door, and He bids all men, women, boys, girls, everywhere to come and have an everlasting relationship with Him. Why does He do this? Because of John 3:16, for God so loves the world. God looked at the rich young ruler, and his heart was filled with love. God has a plan for your life. John recorded that in John 10:10. Jesus said, I've come to give you life, and life more abundant. Walking down the Romans road to salvation, it's just 5 key scripture verses that lead us from point A to point B. Romans 3:23 says, "For all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. Because of our sin, we are separated from God." The penalty of our sin is death. Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Jesus Christ our Lord." Our debt has to be paid. You don't have enough to pay the debt. Jesus paid it for you. That brings us to number three. The penalty of our sin was paid by Jesus Christ. Romans 5:8. "But God demonstrated His love for all of us, just as He did the rich young ruler, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." And last, if we repent of our sin and confess, trust Christ as Lord and Savior, we will be saved from our sins. Romans 10:13, "For whoever calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." Romans 10:9 and 10, "If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus, if you believe in your heart that God has raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes unto righteousness, with the mouth confession is made unto the soul." Over the centuries, Christians have been unified in what salvation in Christ is not. We have agreed over the decades that salvation is not something we earn or deserve. It is by God's grace. Salvation is not one of many ways to get to God. The Apostle Paul records these words in chapter 14, verse 6, when Jesus said, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life." Literally, in its language, what he's saying is, "I am the only way. I am the only truth. I am the only life. No one gets to the Father except through me." The flip is also true. Anybody can come to the Father if they come through me. It's available to all, but it's through Him. All roads, all religions do not lead to God. Salvation is not unconditional reconciliation of all humans. That's a view called universalism, who believe at the end of time everybody's going to make it in because God is so very loving. No, God has chosen you. You must be willing to choose Him. What difference does this make? Once we are born again, once salvation has entered our life, what difference does this make? That's the real question to why I talked about the Barna results earlier. Should this relationship with God, this very personal relationship with a transcendent God, should it make a difference in us? Absolutely. You and I should seek to please God because of what He's done for us, not to earn a relationship with Him. Do you understand the difference? I've known and I've met and I've worked with folks whose life is all screwed up because they never could be good enough for their parents. They were always trying to please them, satisfy them, and they always got judgment from them. That's not the way God relates to you. Like the father with those two boys, Jesus is there with a hose. He can't wait to clean us up, and it brings Him joy. Just because we say, "Yes, God," and we turn in His direction, He is there to meet us. Our response to Him is out of great love, unconditional love He has for us, not so we can earn it. We walk through life in grace. Galatians 3:1-3, "Before your very eyes, Jesus Christ was portrayed as crucified. I would like to learn just one thing from you. Did you receive the Spirit by works or by believing what you heard? Don't be foolish. After walking with the Spirit, don't try to finish in the efforts of the flesh." And then we offer grace to others. We offer grace to members of our family who reject Christ. We offer grace to our neighbors or to ex-spouses. We offer grace to those who gave us our first experience with drugs. We offer God's grace to all. We offer God's grace to those in prison, to those who are homeless, to those who are orphans, to those who are widows. Major Thomas one time said, "There are those who have a life they never live. They have come to Christ and thanked Him for what He did, but they do not live in the power of who He is. Between the Jesus who was and the Jesus who will be, they live in a spiritual vacuum, trying with no little zeal to live for Christ. a life that only He can live in and through them, perpetually begging for what in Him they already have. Grace plus works instead of grace plus nothing. You see, you and I have received the grace of God. We've got all that God is in us for all that God needs. In just a moment, we're going to watch about a 4-minute clip. And then we're going to conclude in a joint prayer together. But I want you to listen. I want you to really focus in. And it's tough at the end of a sermon like this to watch a clip of just words. It'll be spoken. It will be written on the screen. And I want you to hear, and I want you to read. And I want you to let those words penetrate your heart to see how you need to be engaged in our closing prayer this morning. This is extremely important. Let's listen.
Your salvation, of course, derives from the fact that as a redeemed sinner, no longer on the way to hell, but already on the way to heaven, Jesus Christ, as God, Creator, has come to invade your humanity, to play that role in you for which you were created. To give Him the right 24 hours a day in your business, in your home, in your school, on your college campus, whether you're on recreation, in vacation, in business, no matter at any time, under any circumstance, 24 hours in every day, 7 days in every week, you give Jesus Christ as God the right to be God in you without reserve. That's what it means to become a Christian. We've conveniently reduced salvation to a moment in time when we raise a hand, walk down the front, or get baptized, or have our name put upon a church roll, and we call that salvation. Nothing, of course, is farther from the truth. That's totally divorced from the revelation given to us in the Word of God, which is our sole guide in every matter of faith. Salvation involves the reoccupation by God of a guilty sinner in such a way that Jesus Christ has the unchallenged, absolute, perpetual right to dictate the terms whereby that individual henceforth will run his life. For instance, where he's going to buy his new home, what vocation he's going to study for as a student, where he's going to go next year on vacation, how he's actually going to spend his money, who's really going to run the church that he goes to. All this is embraced in his salvation. And nothing less than that, of course, will do. Anything less than that shortchanges Jesus Christ and cheats Him of that for which His blood was shed. And of course, if I'm to discover what the Christian life is all about, there's really only one person to whom I can turn. There's only one person that's ever been capable of living the Christian life since Adam fell, Jesus Christ. So that now He, risen from the dead, might come and perpetuate the life that He lived then in us now. So the Christian life, of course, is the life that Jesus Christ lived then, lived now by Him in us. There is no other. In other words, God to a man is as imperative as oil is to a lamp. If you have an oil lamp and it's got no oil, you've got an oil lamp, but it won't behave like one. You might as well put it in the trash can. And of course, if you detach man from God, which is exactly what happened when Adam fell into sin, you've still got a man in your hands. But he won't behave like one. The only thing that you can do for an oil lamp that hasn't got oil is put oil in it. And the only thing you can do for a car that hasn't got gas is to put gas in it. And the only thing you can do for a man that hasn't got God is to put God in it. And when you put the oil in the lamp, it isn't so that the lamp can try harder. And when through spiritual new birth God gets back into the man, it isn't that the man might try harder. You put oil in a lamp so the oil can be oil functionally. You put gas in a car so that the gas can be gas functionally. And you put God in the man so that God can be God functionally. In other words, spiritual new birth is designed to let God be God in a man's human experience. So that everybody in that man's presence recognizes that God is in residence and God is in business. That it takes God, actually God Himself, not what God has to say, not God's example, not God's precepts, not God as a faraway object of our emulation or worship. It takes God Himself in a man, to be a man. And that's why, as we shall discover, it will take Jesus Christ, not His teachings, not His preaching, not His sublime example, not the beautiful life that He lived, not the doctrines that He promulgated. It will take Jesus Christ Himself, a person, to be a Christian. The Lord Jesus died upon the cross, not just to get you out of hell and into heaven. He died upon the cross to get God out of heaven into you. actually calling the shots, actually controlling what you do with your hands, actually controlling where you go with your feet, actually controlling what you say with your lips, actually controlling what you think with your mind, actually controlling the decisions that you make. That is the measure in which you're saved. So that if any man be in Christ, he's actually, literally, a new creation. He's been made over. He's a new creature. All things that were characteristic of the old Adamic character have passed away, and all things which the next verse tells us there in that passage come from God, the all things have replaced the old things. All things have passed away, and all things have become new.
And Major Thomas just gave us a biblical expression of what it means to have salvation. Which one is you? Which one is me? Is there a radical transformation in our life that produces a radical difference in our lifestyle that makes a difference in the culture that we are a part of? Are we salt and light that penetrates? Or are we salt that has lost its influence and light that has been hidden under a bushel? What kind of parents are we? What kind of spouses are we? What kind of children are we? What kind of children of God are we? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads, and I'd like all of you to join in a prayer with me. You can say this prayer without meaning it, and that's okay, but encourage the person next to you. There may be some of you here who've never invited Jesus Christ in your life. You've been like the rich young ruler. You've been like Agrippa, Felix, a more convenient time. You almost persuaded me to be a Christian, but not quite. And maybe today you are ready to become a Nicodemus, a jailer, a woman at the well, a woman caught in the very act. And maybe you're ready to come to Christ, have an about face. Repent, believe, confess. So with heads bowed, eyes closed, would you all, particularly if these words express the desire of your heart today, would you say this prayer out loud with me? Dear God, I can't, but I believe you can. I believe in Jesus who is God. I believe he died and rose from the dead. I place my faith in him and I accept his eternal life. I have no other plan but to put faith and trust in you. Today I'm doing a 180-degree turn. I will no longer run away, but I will walk with you. I know that you have loved me. I know you submitted to the cross for me. That grace is so amazing. I cannot understand it. But I accept it today. I accept your free gift. And from this moment on, I know I'm saved. I am a child of God. I give the rest of my life to serving you. To experiencing your joy. I thank you today and forevermore. In the name of Jesus. Amen. With your head still bowed, your eyes closed just for a moment. Though you prayed that prayer in unison, if you genuinely prayed that prayer, you had never invited Christ in your life before, but you prayed that prayer. An honest confession of your soul. You want Christ to be your Savior and Lord based on what you've heard today. Would you just quickly hand up, hand down, not for embarrassment, but only because I want to give thanks to God, okay? Some saying I'm tired of being religious, okay? Amen. Amen. For some of you today who you have received Christ in your life, but you have been challenged by the Holy Spirit today that there hasn't been enough difference and distinction in your life because of your walk with Christ. And today, you have made a promise to Him that this life is going to be different from now on. Would you just hand up, hand down, very quickly. Amen. 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 Amen.
Father, thank you. Give us your grace in one more service today. Thank you for new life that you have brought to some in both our services. And Father, thank you for a new vision that maybe you have given to all of us about the difference you want to make in us in this world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.